Hi everyone, how are you today? Welcome back. And if you are new here, welcome to my channel, where you can learn the real-world coding experience. And this is Huang, the coding expert. If you want to pass any coding exam to start your coding career, or if you are already holding a coding credential, working in the field, and want to learn more in order to advance your coding profession, then you are in the right place. It has been a while since the last video that I posted in 2020, so I would like to take this opportunity to wish you and your family a good health, happiness, and prosperity. New Year brings a new beginning and opens a new chapter in our life. It is a new adventure with new opportunities and possibilities. Many of you who watch all my videos and follow my tips and strategy have already passed the CBC exam successfully. Thank you kindly for sharing the good news with me and also sharing my videos on Facebook, Blackboard, WhatsApp, and other social media platforms. I really appreciate all of your help. This is a new learning video series on anatomy and physiology for coder that many of you have requested, and also the highest percentage, 43%, voted on my polling question. As you already know, the IC10 offers greater specificity compared to the old IC9 coding system. Therefore, as a coder, you have to understand anatomy and physiology so that you can accurately assign the code for specific diagnosis, procedures, or treatments. In addition, knowing anatomy and physiology well will also help you to dissect the operative report with ease and confidence. Not to mention, you will impress your boss and your co-worker as well. And last but not least is also to prepare you for any outpatient and inpatient coding exams, either from AAPC or AHIMA. Today's topic is Anatomy and Physiology for Coder in 2021. Chapter 1, The Skeletal System. Alright, without further ado, let's get started. Inside this video, I will go over the type, structure, and function of the skeletal system. Then, I'll show you the location of key bones in the body. Next, the types of fracture. In addition, I'll show you how to break down a medical terminology term into prefix, root word, and suffix. And lastly, I'll go over a case study with you and also give you homework to practice. The skeletal system overview. The human skeletal system consists of bones, cartilage, tendons, and ligaments in the body. An adult skeletal contains 206 bones. Children's skeletons actually contain more bones because some of them, including those of the skull, fuse together as they grow up. There are also some differences in the male and female skeleton. The male skeleton is usually longer and has a higher bone mass. The female skeleton, on the other hand, has a broader pelvis to accommodate for pregnancy and childbirth. Its function is to give shape and structure to the body and provide support, to allow movement, to protect internal organs, to store calcium and other minerals, to produce certain blood cells in the bone marrow. Bones can be classified into 5 major categories. The long bones, for example, femur, thigh bone, or the humerus. Short bones, bones in the wrist and ankle. Flat bones, bones in the skull. Irregular bones, for example, pelvic bones, vertebra, and some facial bones. Sesamoid bones, for example, the kneecap or patella. This slide is about the names of the key bones in our skeletal system. My personal tips to help you learn human anatomy is visualization. I want you to look at this human skeletal and try to keep this image vividly in your head, even when you close your eyes. I also want you to point your finger to each bone and say it out loud when you learn it, so that it will help you to remember them effortlessly. The skull is the bone structure that forms your head. Please point your finger to your head. I know it seems silly, but believe me, it will help you to remember. The maxilla is the bone that forms your upper jaw. The mandible is the bone that forms your lower jaw. The clavicle, also called the collarbones. The ribs add a set of 12 bare bones would form the protective case of the thorax. The sternums or breastbone is a long flat bone located in the central part of the chest. It connects to the ribs and help to protect the heart, lungs, and major blood vessel from injury. Lumbar vertebra are bones that make up the spinal column or backbone, specifically within the lower back. The pelvic girdles is a ring-like bony structure located in the lower part of the trunk. It connects the axial skeleton to the lower limbs. The sacrum is a large triangular bone at the base of the spine. The sacrum forms the posterior pelvic wall, strengthens and stabilizes the pelvic. The coccyx is a small triangular bone, also known as the tailbone. The humerus is a long bone of the upper limbs, which extends from the shoulder to the elbow. The forearm consists of two long bones, the ulna and the radius, with the ulna located on the pinky side, in other words, from the elbow to the small finger, and the radius from the elbow to the thumb side. People often are confused about which bone is inside and which one is outside. The trick for me to remember is that the word radius sounds like a rat is biting my thumb. Ouch! I can feel the pain and see the blood oozing out from the bite. So now, when you hear the word radius, you will remember the rat biting your thumb. Ouch! And you will never forget that. The femur is the only bone located within the human thigh. It is both the longest and the strongest bone in the human body, extended from the hip to the knee. The patella is also known as the kneecap. It sits in front of the knee joints and protects the joint from damage. The lower leg is comprised of two bones, the tibia and the smaller fibula. The tibia, also known as the shin bone, is a larger, stronger, and anterior frontal of the two bones in the leg below the knee. The fibula is the long, thin, and lateral bone of the lower leg. It runs parallel to the tibia or shin bone. The trick for me to remember these two bones are the word tiger for tibia and flea for fibula. Tiger are big and strong, while a flea is small and weak like the two bones. Now, let's look at the bones of the hand. The cable bones are the 8 small bones that make up the wrist. The metacarpal bones are the long bones that connect the carpals or wrist bone to the phalange or finger bone. The phalange are the bones that make up the fingers of the hand. Now, let's look at the bones of the foot. The tarsal, a set of seven irregularly shaped bones. They are situated proximally in the foot in the ankle area. The metatarsal are a group of five long bones in the foot, located between the tarsal and the bone of the toe. The phalanges are the bones of the toe. This slide is about brain exercise to see if you remember the name and location of these bones. I recommend that you should come back to this slide and refresh your memory as much as you can until you remember them all. Let's get started. What is the name of the bone structure that forms your head? You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It is the skull, the bone that forms your upper jaw. You have 10 seconds. It is the maxilla, the bone that forms your lower jaw. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the mandible. The collarbone is called, you have 10 seconds. It's called the clavicle. A set of 12 bare bones would form the protective case of the thorax is called, you have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It's called the ribs, a long flat bone, also called breastbone, located in the central part of the chest. It connects to the ribs and helps to protect the heart, lungs, and major blood vessels from injury. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It is the sternum, the bone that makes up the spinal column or back bones, specifically within the lower back. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the lumbar vertebra, a ring-like bony structure located in the lower part of the trunk. It connects to the axial skeletal to the lower limbs. You have 10 seconds. The time starts now. It's called a pelvic girdle, a large triangular bone at the base of the spine. It forms the posterior pelvic wall, strengthens and stabilizes the pelvic. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It's called a sacrum, a small triangular bone, also known as the tailbone. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts Now, it is the coccyx. Now, let's see how you do with the upper and lower extremity bones. A long bone of the upper limb would extend from the shoulder to the elbow. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the humerus. A long bone of the forearm from the elbow to the thumb side. Remember the bite from your thumb, from the ratch? Ouch! You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It is the radius. A long bone of the forearm from the elbow to the pinky side of the little finger. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the ulna. It is the only bone located within the human thigh. It is both the longest and the strongest bone in the human body. It extends from the hip to the knee. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the femur. It also known as the kneecap. It sits in front of the knee joints and protects the joint from damage. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the patella. The lower leg is comprised of two bones. It also known as the shin bone. Is the larger, stronger, and anterior frontal of the two bones in the leg below the knee. Remember the tiger? You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the tibia. This is the long, thin, and lateral bone of the lower leg. It runs parallel to the tibia or shin bone. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. This is the fibula. Now let's look at the bones of the hand. Eight small bones that make up the wrist. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It's the cable bones. The long bones that connect the cable or wrist bone to the phalanx of your finger. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It's the metacarpal bones. The bones that make up the finger of the hand. You have 10 seconds. Your time starts now. It's called the phalanges. Now, let's look at the bones of the foot. A set of seven irregular shaped bones. They are situated approximately in the foot. in the ankle area. You have 10 seconds. The time starts now. You see the tarsals. A group of five long bones in the foot, located between the tarsal bone and the bone of the toe. You have 10 seconds. The time starts now. It's a metatarsal bones. It's similar to the bones of finger. The bones of the toe are also called. You have 10 seconds. The time starts now. It's also called the phalanges. I hope that you are doing fine with the exercise and you like this format. If so, please let me know for future anatomy and physiology learning videos. Thank you. Let's move on. Fracture. For coding purposes, I want you to know the difference between closed and open fractures, as well as dislocation, so that it will help you assign the correct code for each condition. Open fracture or compound fracture. The bone pokes to the skin and can be seen or a deep wound exposes the bone to the skin. Closed fracture or simple fracture. The bone is broken, but the skin's intact. A dislocation. Instead of a bone breaking, the bones in the joint separate, moving out of their natural position. What are the various types of bone fracture? Transfer fractures is a condition when the bone cracks into two pieces, making a right angle. Linear. The break is parallel to the bone's long axis. Oblique non-display. The bone break but does not move out of alignment. Oblique display. Bone breaks into two or more pieces and move out of alignment. Spiral, also known as torsion fracture, is a type of complete fracture. It occurs due to rotational or twisting force. Green stick or buccal fracture is an incomplete fracture that occurs when the bone starts to bend, crack, or strain, but does not break. Mainly, children are victims of this fracture. Comminuted. When bones get shattered into multiple pieces, the consequential fracture is referred to as a comminuted fracture. Avulsion fracture is a fracture that occurs when the bones and the soft tissue separate, the tendon or ligament pulls up a piece of the bone. Hairline fracture, when there is a small crack in the bone. That's all for the fracture. Just a friendly reminder before we move on to the medical terminology. If you have enjoyed what you have learned so far and appreciate my time spent for this video, then you could please pause the video. Click the like, subscribe, and share buttons below now to support my channel. That would be great. Again, you are the reason why I continue working hard on these videos. It's very time consuming, but it is free. So I don't think it is too much to ask for your support. Thank you so much. And we should move on to learn the medical terminology. Medical terminology is the language used to precisely describe the human body components, processes, illnesses, medical procedures, and pharmacology. Simply put, it is the vocabulary that medical professionals use to describe the body, what it does, and the treatment that it prescribes. Medical terms are used in the field of medicine and clinical setting. Although medical terms have been drawn from many languages, a large majority are from Greek and Latin. Medical terminology is composed of a prefix, root word, and suffix. A prefix is placed at the beginning of a word to modify or change its meaning. Pre means before. Prefixes indicate a location, number, or time. Root, central part of a word containing basic meaning of the term. And the suffix, the ending part of the word that modifies the meaning of the word. For example, myocarditis. We can break down myocarditis into three parts, which will clarify the meanings of this term. The prefix myo means muscle, followed by the root cardi means heart, and then the suffix itis means inflammation. So the meaning of myocarditis is the inflammation of the heart muscle. Common terms. Here is the list of important skeletal system root words and combining forms that you should know for coding purposes. Feel free to write them down in your notebook. Acetabular. For example, acetabulum, what it means, the hip joints. Arthro, arthritis, what it means, joint inflammation. Calcaneal, calcaneus, related to the heel. Cabo, or cabos, it's the wrist bones. Clavicle, clavicular, for example, clavicle is the collarbone. Costo, costo, it relates to the ribs. Cranial, craniums, it is the skull. Femur, for example, femur is the upper leg bone. Fibula, fibula is the lower leg bones. Ili, ilio, for example, ilium is the pelvic bone. Lumbar, for example, lumbar, it related to lumbar region. Malleol, for example, malleolus, it related to the ankle. Mandibular, or mandible, is the lower jaw. Maxillar, maxilla, it is the upper jaw. Common terms continue. Metacarpal, metacarpals, the bones of the hand. Metatarsal, metatarsals, bones of foot. Olecranal, for example, olecranus is the elbow. Patel, patella is the kneecap. Phalanx, phalanxes, bones of fingers and toes. Bulb, bulbus, portion of pelvic bone. Radii, radio, radius, lower arm bone. Sac, sacral, sacrum, sacral area of spine. Scapula, 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 shoulder blade. Stern, sternum, sternum, breastbone. Tars, tarsal, tarsals, ankle bones. Tibia, tibial, tibia, lower leg bones. Ul, ulna, ulna, lower arm bones. Common surface. Below are some common suffixes that you should know for coding the skeletal system. Remember, suffix is the ending part of a word that modifies the meaning of the word. Algia means pain. Asthenia means weakness. Synthesis means puncture to aspirate. Glacia, glasses, glassed means to break. Disease means surgical fixation, biting. Ectomy means excision, surgical removal. Itis means inflammation. Osis means abnormal condition. Physis means growth. Plasty means surgical repair, reconstruction. Porosis means pore, passes. Graphy means suture. Schisis means to split. Trophy means development. All right, let's do some medical terminology practice. In order to understand the medical terminology terms, you have to know how to break down the word into prefix, root, and suffix. For example, the first word, atosynthesis. Ato means joints. Synthesis means aspiration, removal of fluid. So when we put it all together, atosynthesis means removal or aspiration of fluid from a joint. Let's look at the second term, hematosis. Hem, a hemo, means blood. Ato means joints. And osis means abnormal condition. So when we put it all together, hematosis means abnormal condition of bleeding in your joints. Let's look at the last word, rhinoplasty. Rhino means nose. Plasty means plastic surgery, surgical repair. So when we put it all together, rhinoplasty means plastic surgery performed on the nose. I hope that now you understand how to approach a complex medical terminology by breaking it down into simpler pieces to figure out what it means. Let's do a case study together. Before you start coding a case study or a real case at work, I want you to know that your focus should be to find out two main objects, the diagnosis and the procedure. For the diagnosis, you need to find out first the final diagnosis, then any secondary diagnosis or comorbidity that could complicate or affect the treatment. And if it is an injury case, then you have to obtain the information how and where that happens. For the procedure, similarly, you need to find out what is the primary procedure. And also, if there is any secondary procedure, if it applies. Now, let's read the case. This 5-year-old female fell from a playground equipment at the public park and was unable to bear weight on the left leg. X-ray today determined that she sustained a mid-shaft fracture of the femur, which was reduced and placed in a spiker cast. Would IC-10CM and CPT code are appropriate for reporting? I just highlighted the key element for diagnosis and procedure, so please pause the video and open both your IC-10CM and CPT books to find the codes needed for this case. This is not for the exam, so please take your time and come back when you're done. I'll just book 1 minute music while waiting for you. Feel free to turn it off or mute it if you don't want. and thank you. Assuming that you already looked them up in your books and hear what you got. S72.3028, unspecified fracture of sac of left femur, initial encounter for closed fracture. According to the coding guidelines, when the physician does a document open or close, the default option is closed fracture. W09.AXXA, forearm or form other playground equipment initial encounter. When you call an injury, or when you see the diagnosis code, start with letter S for injury. If you remember from my lesson, then you need to report the external cause code for how and where that happened. W92.830 Public park as the place of occurrence of the external cause. For the CBT procedure, you should use 27502 modified LT for the left side, close treatment of femoral shaft fracture with manipulation with the without skeletal traction. You do not call separately for cast or splint application. Is it bundled into the fracture repair course? I hope you remember this. If you didn't get it correctly the first time, don't feel discouraged. This is the reason why you learn. So try to do it again until you find the course. When you found out, take note and highlight the main terms or the path that leads you there. This is your homework. The patient was hit in the face by baseball on the baseball field when playing baseball with his friends, sustaining a 2.3 cm superficial laceration to the right medial cheek. X-rays reveal a nasal fracture that requires stabilization. The emergency department physician stabilized the fracture with a splint and tape and repairs the laceration with simple suture of the skin. How should you call for this visit? For the diagnosis, your focus should be to find out two main objectives, the diagnosis and the procedure. For the diagnosis, you need to find out the final diagnosis. Then, any secondary diagnosis or comorbidity that could complicate or affect the treatment. And apparently this is an injury case, so you need to obtain the information how and where it happens. For the procedure, similarly, you need to find out what is the primary procedure, and also if there's any secondary procedure, if this applies. I'll go over it in the next lesson. That's all for today. Thank you so much for watching, for liking and sharing this video. If you find this video helpful, informative and easy to learn with this format. Or if you have any suggestion, then please leave me a comment below just to let me know. I really appreciate it. Also, the more comments that you leave for me, the better chance for my video will be reviewed by other people. So please continue to do so. Until next time, have a great day.